Morning. Welcome back to Calvary Community Chapel, Front Royal. You can't hear me. You want me to do this? Ken, is that better? All right, I'll get up here where I'm eating this microphone. All right. Again, welcome. And for our announcements today, we do have Agape Feast downstairs afterwards, so there will be a nice meal available for anyone who wants to join. Also, I want to give thanks and praise to the Lord for all he provided for Connie Good this week. The Lord finally revealed exactly what was wrong with her and was able to provide everybody on an emergency basis to take care of it for a successful surgery. Gary has said that she is doing better, doing well, recuperating at home. So we, the prayers are they're thankful for the prayers, and as you continue to pray for successful healing, and we do that. So we just praise God for all that was done there. Also, Pastor Paul has asked for prayer for his upcoming surgery for himself on August 25th for a successful surgery. We are praying that the Lord's will be done. That is what is always our desire, that the Lord's will be done. We trust in that. So we're going to lift him up in prayer. Also, pray for Brenda. She's not feeling well, and she's also sick. So keep her in prayer as well. We have a upcoming men's breakfast next Saturday at 8 o'clock down on the Davis River property. So if you have any questions about how to get there, talk to me or John back there, or Johnny. We can tell you how to get there, Pastor Paul. We all know how to get there. Come and join us for men's breakfast fellowship. Also, the men's retreat. Today is the last day. Well, actually, tomorrow is the last day. But today is probably the last day that you can get your payment to John Davis back there. So if you want to go to the men's retreat, please fill out this form. Forms are out there outside. And fill it out with a check and give the paperwork to John. And I highly encourage you to consider going to that if you haven't considered it. I know it's going to be an awesome time of fellowship and prayer, and for the men to get together, a great time of learning. The theme is the armor of God. So I know Pastor Dave has requested that people even cancel their plans. So he sees it as a very important thing to do, and I do too. We welcome today Byron Crenshaw as our teacher today from Calvary Chapel. I should say Pastor Byron from Calvary Chapel Manassas, as well as his wife Adriana and Ben, son. And thankful, and thank you for being here today. Glad you could be with us today. I'm looking forward to the teaching today and the topic that he's going to be teaching on, or I don't know how long, but as long as it takes. So that all said, silence your cell phones if you haven't already, of which I'm mindful right now that I did not do that. So bear with me while I do that. I do not want that thing going off while Byron's teaching. So please stand if you would now. For the reading of our scripture today is Daniel 9, verses 24 through 27. It's a little lengthy, but it's a great scripture. Beginning with verse 24. Daniel writing, 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem, until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublesome times. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the Prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate. Bow your heads with me in prayer, please. Father God, Lord, we thank you again for the opportunity to gather together as the body of Christ. We thank you, Father, that we come as family before you, asking God for your blessing upon your word today, that you would give us clear understanding, that you would open our minds, reveal whatever needs to be revealed to us clearly in understanding. And we thank you, Father, for our teacher today, for his understanding of the scripture. And Lord, we just ask God that you were glorified in it all, that we ask that you would rebuke the master of confusion, which is Satan, and that he would not be allowed to confuse any of this, that you would protect the seeds that are planted and would not allow it to be snatched out or confused or any interject anything, Lord, that is not of you. So, Father, we thank you for this time that we can come together. We thank you for the music, the words of the music that are provided. Lord, as we sing to you, I pray, Almighty God, that you would bless this time of fellowship and singing. And Father, we thank you and praise you for what you have done for Connie and for the healing that has taken place, for all that was provided for her. We pray, Father, for Paul and Brenda, Lord, that you would bless them and heal them, and that you would provide a successful surgery, Lord. Father, we lift to you all that has taken place and all who have been through different kinds of trials and tribulations this week. But we praise you and thank you, God, for how you are always faithful in all things. You are our strength and our salvation in every way. Thank you for saving our souls through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show.
Lift up his name. Lord, I lift your name. I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad. So glad you're in my life.
Lord, we lift your name.
You are worthy. grave. He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered.
Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise. infinitely sweet. This great love that hides redeems as one.
This time of worship and song service. As always, we just pray, Lord, that you would keep our hearts and our minds in an attitude of worship as we study your word. We thank you that it is an act of worship, just like singing and just like giving, to study your word. What a wonderful act of worship. So, Father, keep us prepared. Teach us by your Holy Spirit. For you have said that he will lead us into all truth. And we trust that to you by faith. And those in agreement said, amen.
Amen.
Would you all welcome my good friend and colleague, Pastor Byron Crenshaw.
Thank you, Brother Paul. Well, good morning. How are we doing today? All right. Well, it is truly an honor for me to be here. And I am joined by my lovely wife, Adriana, and my little prayer warrior, Benjamin. Yeah, he is a prayer warrior indeed. All right. How many of you brought Bibles? Good thinking. We're going to be using them today. How about that? So I was asked to speak today on a kind of interesting subject. We're going to spend the next 3 weeks, beginning today, on the subject of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. The pre-tribulation rapture of the church. But before we begin this incredible series, we dare not do so without asking the Lord's blessing. So I'm going to ask one more time, if you please, bow your hearts with me and pray with me. Our most holy and merciful Father who art in heaven, Father, we are here right now to honor your divine name. Father, there isn't a single soul in this room that has come to hear from me. But we've all gathered in the name of your Son, Yeshua, Jesus the Christ, to hear from you. So it is our prayer, Father, that you please put me behind the shadow of the cross. And let your Holy Spirit be our teacher for this lesson. And give us all ears to hear and hearts to understand. And we ask these things in the name of your Son, Yeshua the Christ. Amen. 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 Well, this morning's lesson will be part one of a three-part series on the subject of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Now, as I was preparing this lesson, I was reminded by something that a dear friend of mine, a guy named Chuck Missler, once said. And this is what he said. He said, of all of the subjects of theology, the pre-tribulation rapture of the church is the most preposterous event ever described. And the only thing that it has going for itself is that it is absolutely correct. Chuck said that. Yet the subject of the rapture of the church has always been one of controversy, primarily because there are several different views regarding the destiny of the church that are held by different churches as well as different theologians. Now, there are three major views and a couple of minor views. But the three major views are respectfully known as the pre-tribulation rapture, the mid-tribulation rapture, or pre-wrath, they're closely related, or the post-tribulation rapture. Now, there are other views regarding the destiny of the church as well. There's the partial rapture view, and then there's something called the preterist view. But they're not as widely held as the other three views, and I will define each of these different views during this lesson. So, we're going to spend 3 weeks beginning today, Lord willing, that is, if we don't get raptured, looking at why we believe that the pre-tribulation rapture view is indeed the correct view that is most supported by Holy Scripture. But church, before I jump into this section, I want to be very clear about something. Whether you are a pre-tribulationist, a mid-tribulationist, or pre-wrath, or a post-tribulationist has no bearings on your salvation. I want to be clear about that. The subject of the tribulation is important to us, that's true. But church, we must be mature enough not to allow peripheral theology to disrupt the union that binds the body of Christ together. What binds the body of Christ together, church, is not when Jesus is coming, but what binds the body of Christ together again is that Jesus is coming. And until such time, our mission continues to be to go there forth into all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that Christ Jesus has commanded. That's our mission until the day the Lord comes to take us home. And to that, I think we can all say amen. Okay, so to begin this lesson, let's start by setting aside, for now, our views regarding the rapture of the church, whether the church is raptured before the tribulation, during the tribulation, or after the tribulation, okay? Let's start with a fresh mind. Whenever you take on a study like this, the best thing to do always is to start with a fresh mind, set aside all your presuppositions, and let's begin with some of the very basics. Let's go back to fundamentals, and let's start by defining our terms. So, what is the rapture? We'll start with that one. Now, the word rapture is the Greek word hapazo. Please say it with me one time, hapazo. Hapazo. That's strong reference number 726. And throughout this series, I'll be giving you the strong reference number to certain words. I do this because I don't want you to be converted to my theology. That is not why I'm here. I want you to be able to look up these things for yourselves, be able to understand them from yourselves. And this way, if you're in a position of explaining it to others, you're not placed in a position where you're saying, well, that's what my pastor teaches me. You'll be able to explain it for yourself. So that's strong reference number 726. It's the word hapazo. This word is found 13 times in the Bible. And it means to be snatched up, to be caught up, to be seized by someone or something. This word is translated to catch up or to catch 5 times, to take by force 3 times, to catch away 2 times, to pluck away 1 time, and to pull 1 time. Now, an example of how this word is used can be found in Acts chapter 8, verse 39. This is where Philip is sent to evangelize to the Ethiopian eunuch, and the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more. Now, in that text, the word hapazo is translated snatched or snatched up. Another example is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 4. This is what the Apostle Paul wrote. He wrote this: I know a man in Christ who 13 years ago, whether in the body I do not know or out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a man was caught up to the third heaven. And I know how such a man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words which a man is not permitted to speak. Close quote. Now, in that passage, the word hapazo is translated caught up. And there are other examples, and we'll get to some of them during this series. Now, some have said that the word rapture does not appear in your Bible. Have any of you heard that before? Yeah, so have I. Well, not only is that not true, but it's actually a very bad statement made out of ignorance. What they really mean to say is that the word rapture does not appear in your English Bible. That's what they really mean to say. And that would be true. And that's because the word rapture is not English in its origin. It's Latin. So if you were reading the Latin Bible, let's say the Latin Vulgate, is a translation of Holy Scripture. It was translated by a guy named Jerome. He was a biblical scholar who served during the 4th century. But if you were reading the Latin Vulgate, you would find the word rapio or the word rapturo, which is in English rapture. So the Latin translation for the Greek word hapazo is the word rapio or rapturo, and it carries the same exact meaning as the word hapazo, the one that's found in the Greek manuscripts. It is describing the actual removal from one place to another. It means to be carried away in spirit or in body. The rapture of the church means the carrying away of the people of the church of Jesus Christ from one place to another. Now, while most Christian denominations do believe that there will be a rapture, they differ, however, on when that rapture will occur. So, with that said, we need to now look at the definition of the tribulation period. Now, some of these denominations believe that the church will be raptured before the tribulation. Some believe it will be raptured during the tribulation, and some after the tribulation. So, it's in our best interest that we define the tribulation period. The word tribulation is one of several English translations of the Greek word thlipsis. Thlipsis. This noun is found approximately 50 places in Holy Scripture, and it carries a primary sense of persecution or affliction. The Hebrew translation of this word thlipsis is tsar or tsara. Now, the Christian Holman Bible Dictionary defines the word tribulation as follows. Listen carefully. Quote, tribulation, trouble or pressure of a general sort. In some passages, particular time of suffering associated with the events of the end time. In this sense, it is describing a tribulation surpassing any trouble yet experienced in human history. Close quote. Now, the Holy Bible is full of accounts of tribulations, right, that have occurred throughout entire our history. Now, for example, the period of Israel's servitude to Egypt, that was a tribulation. The period of Israel's servitude to Babylon, that was a tribulation. In fact, the entire book of the Judges is about Israel's sin, tribulation, repentance, and then the pattern repeats itself throughout the entire book. That whole thing is about tribulation. Then you have the tribulation that was experienced by the Jews from the man named Haman. It's found in the book of Esther. Haman, by the way, was kind of the original Adolf Hitler who planned to exterminate all the Jews. And then you have the tribulation that was experienced by the Christian church at the hands of the Jews during the first century. And then if that wasn't bad enough, then you had the tribulation from the Romans. Right after the Jewish persecution, then you had the church being persecuted by the Romans. And then there was various forms of tribulation under the various popes of the Roman Catholic Church. You have tribulation from Muslim community. And the list really goes on and on. Now, most of these tribulation events have nothing to do with eschatology, right? The study of end times. We need to be able to discern tribulation events that are not part of eschatology from tribulation events that are part of eschatology, or at the very least, tribulation events that are a precursor to eschatology. Now, end time tribulation passages are often easy to spot if you just pay attention to the text, because they typically will end with the removal of evil from the world or a national repentance of the Jewish people just before the return of Christ Jesus. Now, the definition of tribulation provided by the Christian Holman Dictionary, that definition makes a clear distinction between a past tribulation and a particular future tribulation of great severity. Now, none other than our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ himself gives us a definition of the tribulation period as found in what we call the Olivet Discourse, Matthew chapter 24. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open up to Matthew chapter 24, to the Olivet Discourse, and let's read the passage together. We're going to begin, for the sake of time, at verse number 29. We're going to bounce around just a little bit, but I want to show you something beginning at verse number 29. Matthew chapter 24. So let me paint the scene for us while you're turning there. This is right after Christ Jesus was with his disciples. They were at the Temple Mount. And the disciples were trying to impress our Lord and Savior with the buildings of the temple. They were saying to him, Lord, look at these wonderful buildings, you know. And they were expecting Christ Jesus to say, oh, wonderful, yes, good job, you know. He doesn't do that. Instead, he pronounces a prophecy on where the Jewish temple was going to be destroyed, stone by stone. And then they leave the Temple Mount. By the time we get to this verse here, they're already sitting at the Mount of Olives. Think of it as walking across the street, right? Going from the Temple Mount, then you go across the street, you hit the Mount of Olives. It's just a few feet away. It's not that far. So that's where they are, at the Mount of Olives. We're going to pick it up at verse number 29. Jesus is answering three questions that they asked him back in verse 3. They asked him, Lord, you know, when will these things happen, referring to the temple being destroyed? And what would be the sign of your coming and the sign of the end of the age or the end of the world? And this prophecy is by far one of the most incredible prophecies ever declared. But verse 29, Jesus says this, but immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light and the stars will fall from the sky and the powers of the heaven will be shaken. All right, stop there. So he's talking about some of the events that's going to take place immediately following the tribulation. All right? These are what's called mile markers. Now, I want you to back up to verse 15. Verse 15, he talks about the great tribulation. In verse 15, he says, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, I'll get back to that, standing in the holy place, then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains. Whoever is on the housetop must not go down to get things out of his house. And whoever is in the field must not turn back to get his cloak. But woe to those women who are pregnant and those who are nursing babies in those days. Moreover, pray that when you flee, it will not be in the winter or on the Sabbath. Why? Look what comes next, verse 21. For then there will be a great tribulation. For then there will be a great tribulation such as has not occurred since the beginning of the world until now, nor ever will again. Let me stop there. Really? That's pretty disturbing. When you think about everything that the human on this earth had experienced since our creation, we've gone through some horrific things. Think of the countless diseases that have wiped out millions and millions of people, and all the wars we have fought, and the bloodshed. We had World War I. And if that wasn't bad enough, we did it a second time, right? World War II. We dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We've gone through some horrible stuff. But yet here Christ Jesus is telling us this time is going to be so bad, it's going to be something that the world has never experienced. But look what he says in verse number 22. And if those days had not been cut short, no life would have been saved. No life would be saved. That gives you an idea on how bad this really must be. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. And then the prophecy goes on and concludes with the return of Christ Jesus. So, there is no ambiguity here in the English nor in the Greek. There will be a future tribulation period that will include a time of great tribulation, something that the world has never experienced. And unless those days of the great tribulation period is cut short by God himself, the Bible says no flesh will survive it. But those days will be shortened. Why? For the elect's sake, for the sake of those who are elected by God during that time. I have a question for you. Who's the elect? We'll get to that in a minute. Now, the timing in which theologians place this tribulation is one of the major components that defines their eschatology views regarding the rapture of the church. Now, although there is a general conformance among theologians that the Bible does speak of a time of great tribulation of the saints on the earth, there is generally disagreement regarding when that tribulation will take place, and who the elect of the saints are, and when they will all experience this. Now, the two extreme views held on opposite ends here is the preterist view and the post-tribulation view. Now, the preterist view, they believe that the saints are members of the church and that this severe tribulation that Christ Jesus talks about has already occurred. They hold the view that that event occurred in the year 70 AD. When Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans. The post-tribulation view, that's on the direct opposite side, they believe that the saints is in fact the church and that the tribulation period spoken of by Christ Jesus has not yet occurred. Now, in between these two extreme views, you have all of the other views. You have the pre-tribulation view, the mid-tribulation view, and the pre-wrath view in between these two extremes. Now, another problem in understanding the tribulation period is due to the different titles given to the tribulation period. Now, some of these titles given throughout all of Holy Scripture describe either a portion of the tribulation period or the entire tribulation period. For example, in the Old Testament, we have titles for the tribulation period such as this, the time of Jacob's troubles. That's in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. The Day of Vengeance, that's in Isaiah chapter 34, verse 8, and Isaiah chapter 61, verse 2. It's called the Day of Gloominess. You'll find that in Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 15, and again in Joel chapter 2, verse 2. And it's called the 70th week of Daniel. That's in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, and it's just to name a few. These are all end-time eschatology descriptions. Now, in the New Testament, we find these titles. The Day of the Lord. That's in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 2. It's called the Great Day of the Wrath of the Lamb of God. That's in Revelation chapter 6, verse 16, and again in chapter 6, verse 17. It's called the Tribulation in Matthew chapter 24, verse 29. It's called the Great Tribulation in chapter 24, verse 21 of Matthew. It's also called the Great Tribulation in the book of Revelation in two places, chapter 2, verse 22, and again in chapter 7, verse 14. It's called the Wrath of God in Revelation chapter 15, verse 1. It's called the Wrath to Come in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. Now, all of these different titles are describing the same end-time event, this eschatology period of time known as the tribulation, or it's describing portions of time within the tribulation period. So, let us now define the timing of the tribulation period through Holy Scripture. Now, in the Olivet Discourse, that's in Matthew chapter 24, it's repeated in Mark chapter 13 and again in Luke chapter 21. In the Olivet Discourse, Christ Jesus places the start of the Great Tribulation period when the abomination of desolation is set up. The abomination of desolation. So that becomes our mile marker, our starting point. Look again at Matthew chapter 24 at verse 15. This is Christ Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach. He says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, then he goes on. So, that's our starting point. Let us examine what Holy Scripture says about the abomination of desolation and determine from there the timing of the Great Tribulation period. And by default, we should be able to determine the timing of the tribulation period as a whole. So, with that said, get and turn to Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9, we'll begin reading at verse number 24. What's happening here in Daniel chapter 9 is Daniel is receiving, you can almost call this the Old Testament equivalent to the Olivet Discourse. He's getting this prophecy directly from an angelic being. In fact, church, this prophecy here in Daniel chapter 9 is so detailed that many opponents of Holy Scripture had tried to argue that this prophecy here had to have been written way after the death of Christ Jesus because it's that detailed. If you study this prophecy close enough, you'll discover that not only does this prophecy contain a description of the destruction of Jerusalem as it occurred in the year 70 AD, but it also describes and details the exact timing that Christ Jesus would present himself as the Messiah. So they argue that it had to have been written after the fact, but you know what silenced them? What I call the greatest discovery of the 20th century. Some years ago, back in 1946, I believe it was, a little Bedouin boy out in the desert of Israel, picking up rocks, throwing them inside a cave. And he threw one, and something shattered. He went in to investigate, and he comes out with the greatest discovery of the 20th century. And, of course, I'm referring to the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Among the writings of these scrolls, by the way, these scrolls dated back to be 200 years old before the birth of Jesus Christ. Among the writings within this scroll was a complete copy of the book of Daniel. How about that? How about that? Silence all those critics just like that. Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 begins with these words, 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city. We need to understand the 70 weeks. What exactly is the 70 weeks? We'll get to that. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. All right, let's stop here. Now, although the time duration in this prophecy is described as 70 weeks in verse 24, the 70 weeks are actually a period of 70 years of 7 years. Think of it as 70 times 7 for a total of 490 years. The original word used in this text for the word weeks, that's in the Hebrew, is the word Shabua. Say it with me one time, please, Shabua. When you say that word Shabua, you're saying sevens. That's what the word means. That's strong reference number 7620. Although the word Shabua is commonly translated as weeks, 119 times out of 120 times, the Hebrew word is used differently in Holy Scripture than how we would typically use the word weeks. It literally translates to saying seventh or sevens in the Tanakh, the Old Testament. It's used in describing a period of time before completion. So for us, in our vernacular, we have a seven-day week, correct? But did you know in Holy Scripture they have a seven-month week as well as a seven-year week? Genesis chapter 2 is where we get the definition of the seven-day week. But if you go to Leviticus chapter 23, verse 15, you'll find an example of a seven-month week. And then when you get to Exodus chapter 23, verse 10 and 11, you'll find an example of a seven-year week. The word that's used there is the word Shabua. Are you still with me? All righty. Now, a common mistake that confuses people is failure to recognize that these Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek words may carry different meanings when you translate them into English. In the passage we just read, this particular passage is describing a period of 70 sevens, which was the ancient Hebrew way of saying 70 years of 7 years, or 70 weeks of years. So, if one Shabua is 7 years, how much is two Shabua? 14 years. Good. I just want to make sure you're still with me. Each week or each Shabua equals 7 years, and this passage is saying 70 Shabua has been determined for Israel. How many total years is 70 Shabua? 490 years. Okay. Now, we need to recognize who is the primary focus of this prophecy. Look at the text again. 70 weeks are determined for who? For your people and for your holy city. He's talking to Daniel. So, right from the beginning, we learned that the prophecy is about Israel and the holy city, Jerusalem. Now, although other areas and other nations will be directly involved in this event that's about ready to be described in Daniel chapter 9, the primary focus, based on what we just read, is Israel. That becomes important. Back to verse 24. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Now, verse 24 describes that the 70 weeks of years are determined for Israel and Jerusalem to accomplish six specific things. Number one, to finish transgression. Number two, to make an end of sins. Number three, to make reconciliation for iniquity. Number four, to bring in everlasting righteousness. Number five is to seal up vision and prophecy. And number six is to anoint the most holy. Verse 25. Now therefore, and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks. And for those of you who don't mind writing in your Bibles, you might want to underline that word and. 70 weeks and 7 weeks and 62 weeks. It goes on to say the street shall be built again and the wall even in troublesome time. All right, let's stop there. Church, let me slow down a bit because this here, at this point, is where people get tripped up. Because they fail to recognize two important things from this section of Holy Scripture. One is that the 70 weeks of years are divided into three stages. One is the 70 weeks of years is divided into three stages. And two, here's the second one. The 70 weeks of years are not continuous. Those two things people tend to miss. Verse 25 predicts that the time from when the command is given to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, comes will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. This is describing two stages. Stage one is 7 Shebuah, and stage two is 62 Shebuah. But stage two, the 62 Shebuah, does not occur until after the stage one is completed. Are you still with me? Okay. So stage one, the 7 Shebuah, plus stage two, the 62 Shebuah, equals a total of 69 Shebuah, or 69 weeks of years. But the prophecy is for how many years? 70. Right. So we're missing one. What comes next is the second thing a lot of people get tripped up on, and they miss. Verse 26 describes events that will take place after stages 1 and 2, but before stage 3. Stage 3 is the 70th week of Daniel, that last week. But we must make note of all of the events that take place in between stages 2 and 3. Verse 26. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with the flood until the end of the war, desolations are determined. Okay, let's stop here. Verse 26 of this prophecy describes the events that will take place after stage 2, which is after the 62 weeks of years have passed, right? When a total of 69 weeks have passed. So after stages 1 and 2, there is this unspecified gap of time before the beginning of the 70th week of Daniel. Do you see that? That's stage 3. During that gap of time, in between the 69th and 70th weeks of years, the following events occur. Number one, the Messiah will be killed. Number two, the people of the prince who was to come will destroy the sanctuary. Number three, the end of the war will be with the flood, which is an idiom, by the way, for power. That's in Daniel chapter 11, verse 22. And will bring in about the desolation of Jerusalem. And number four, it says desolations. Notice it's plural. Will continue until the end of the war. All of these events take place in between the 69th and 70th week of Daniel. Now, although the duration of this gap of time in between the 69th and 70th weeks is unspecified, it is at the very least 2,000 years. At the very least. Because during this, in between this time, you know, the Messiah will be killed, the temple will be destroyed, and Jerusalem will be destroyed. Church, the Jewish temple was destroyed twice in history. Once by a guy named Nebuchadnezzar. That was in the year 586 BC. You'll find that reference in 2 Kings chapter 25, verses 8 through 10. The second time it was destroyed by a Roman emperor by the name of Titus Vespasian. That happened in the year 70 AD, when Titus Vespasian sent in Roman legions 5, 10, 12, and 15 into Jerusalem, and they destroyed the temple just the way Christ Jesus predicted how the temple would be destroyed. So we know, since verse 26 describes that the Messiah is executed before the destruction of the temple, we know that this temple, this prophecy, occurred in the year 70 AD. We know now that this prophecy is describing events that have yet to take place. When you look carefully at the text, it describes the people of the prince who was to come. The people of the prince who was to come would have to be the Romans. If this event is describing the execution of Christ Jesus and the destruction of the temple, then we know that the people of the prince who was to come would have to be the Romans. This also means that the prince who shall come will be in some way connected with Rome, either religiously, politically, or nationally, or perhaps all three. Now, verse 27 begins the prophecy of the 70th week, that missing week. It describes that after the events that are in between the 69th and 70th week, the prince who shall come will confirm a covenant with, quote, the many, close quote. I'll get back to that. He is going to confirm this covenant for the last remaining week or the last 7 years. This remaining week of years is what is commonly referred to as the 70th week of Daniel. The 70th week of Daniel. Look at verse 27. Then he, stop there, who is the he in this passage? Well, that would be the prince who was to come. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, in the middle of the week, how many years would that be? Say it loud. 3.5 years. If a week is 7 years, that's 3.5 years. That becomes important. In the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate. Okay, let's stop there. So during this period, the following events are prophesied to take place. Number one, the prince who shall come will confirm a covenant with the many. Number two, during the middle of that 7 year period, which is 3.5 years later, this prince will violate this covenant and bring an end to sacrifice and offering. That's another important key to remember. And number three, an act of an abomination is committed, followed by, and it's going to be enforced by, a person identified as one who makes desolate. Don't assume that's the same person described earlier, the prince who shall come. They're not. Now, the text states that the prince who was to come will confirm a covenant with Israel. It uses the word confirm. The emphasis is that this is an existing covenant that's being confirmed, not the establishment of a new covenant that so many people make the error of assuming. Since verse 27 also describes Israel performing traditional temple worship activities, sacrificing, offerings, this covenant is most likely the Abrahamic covenant, also known as the land covenant. The Temple Mount is required for them to perform these religious acts. This is most likely the Abrahamic covenant. Now, currently, the Temple Mount is one of several land spaces in Israel that is occupied and fully controlled by the Palestinians. The confirming of this Abrahamic covenant, or the land covenant, implies that an agreement must be reached between the Jews and the Palestinians in such a way that it will grant the Jews access to either all or portions of the Temple Mount to rebuild their highly anticipated Jewish temple. But guess what, church? In Leviticus chapter 26, verse 9, and again it's stated in verse 42, it states that God alone will confirm the Abrahamic covenant and no one else. In fact, Leviticus chapter 26, verses 40 and 41 states that the Jews must first repent and return to God before he will confirm that covenant. The prince who shall come will not only confirm this Abrahamic covenant, but he will offer a way for the Jews to get access to that land space in such a way where they won't have to repent of their sins nor accept Christ Jesus as their Lord and Savior. In addition, there's more. The prince who shall come will go as far as to set himself up to be worshipped as God in the temple. We'll talk more about that when we get to part two. This prince who shall come fits the timing, fits the description, fits the characteristics of the beast of the sea described in Revelation chapter 13, was also commonly referred to as the Antichrist. The Antichrist. I don't like using that term. The reason why is because it paints the wrong picture. When we hear the term Antichrist, we think of a dark and sinister and evil and foul person, right? Right, and he is. But he doesn't come across that way. He comes across as a peacemaker, as a savior. While people are looking for this evil and sinister guy, the Antichrist might be right under their noses. The reference to the prince who shall come bringing in an end to the sacrifice and offering, that also implies that the Jewish temple must have been rebuilt in order for them to have to be doing the sacrifice and offerings. The temple had to have been rebuilt. Has the Jewish temple been rebuilt yet, in case you noticed? No. What is occupying that land space right now? Yeah, a place, a structure known as the Dome of the Rock, which is Islam's third most holiest site. So what does that tell us? This is still yet to happen. These are events that are yet to occur. The sacrifice and offerings are done after the covenant is confirmed with the Jews by this man, this coming world leader. This means that this prince who shall come will establish something that no modern day leader has ever accomplished. All of the major leaders of our world has had their shot at trying to bring some type of agreement, a peace treaty between the Jews and the Palestinians, and every last one of them have failed. This guy's going to succeed, but it's going to be a false peace. The consummation that is poured out on the desolate that is described, church, that's a divine judgment. It's a divine judgment from Almighty God himself. And the people who support this abomination are the targets of this judgment. Now, that is explained in greater details in Daniel chapter 11. We'll get to that later. Now, there's something else I need you to see in verse 27. I want you to make note of the wording in verse 27. Then shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wings of abomination, look what comes next, shall be one who makes desolate, shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate. All right, so that phrase, shall be one who makes desolate, church, this is describing another person other than the prince who shall come. The phrase is translated, shall come one who makes desolate in the Amplified Bible. That point that it's what it's emphasizing is that this is indeed a different person other than the prince who shall come. This person is a supporter of the prince who shall come, kind of like a protege of the prince who shall come. This person is the one who enforces the rules of the prince who shall come. This person fits the timing, the description, and the characteristics of the beast of the earth that is described in Revelation chapter 13, a person who was commonly referred to as the false prophet. This person here will force the entire world to worship the prince who is to come, aka the Antichrist. Now, in summary of verse 27, the start of the 70th week of Daniel begins with the coming prince, who is also called the beast of the sea in Revelation chapter 13. He's going to confirm a covenant with the Jews for 7 years. The Antichrist forming this false alliance starts the 70th week of Daniel, a period of time known as the 7-year tribulation period. It begins with a lie from the father of lies. Church, that is the origin of the 70th week of Daniel, the 7-year tribulation period. During the first 3.5 years of this false covenant, the Jews will be allowed to rebuild their Jewish temple and recommence traditional Jewish worship services with offerings and sacrifices. However, halfway through that 7-year period, which is 3.5 years later, this covenant is going to be violated by this prince who shall come. He's going to violate the covenant in such a way it brings an end to the Jewish offerings and sacrifices done on the Temple Mount. He's going to commit an act of abomination that's going to usher in, as Christ Jesus put it, the Great Tribulation. Remember, Christ Jesus pointed us to Daniel to understand the Great Tribulation. And what was that mile marker? When you see the abomination of desolation set up. That's the abomination of desolation in Daniel chapter 9, when this prince who shall come will violate the covenant and desecrate that temple. The prince who shall come. A person who is in full alliance with this coming prince, identified in the text as one who makes desolate. He's the one that is identified in Revelation chapter 13 as the beast of the earth. Now, in looking at the events of this prophecy of Daniel chapter 9, where are we today in regards to these weeks of years? Has any of the events that are described in the 70th week of Daniel occurred yet? The answer is no. So where are we? We are in between the 69th and 70th week of Daniel right now. We are in that moment of pause. And don't be surprised that there is a moment of pause there. There are actually several moments of pause throughout all of Holy Scripture. There are several of them. In fact, when you read the accounts in the book of Revelation, all of the events that are taking place, you get seven sealed judgments followed by seven trumpet judgments followed by seven bowl judgments. When you read that carefully, at the end of each of those judgments, there's a moment of pause. There is this moment of pause. One of my favorite examples to give regarding the moment of pause, I'm going off script here, but this is important for you to get, is when Christ Jesus enters the synagogue and begins his ministry by reading from the book of Isaiah. Have you guys read that passage before where he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and then he goes on to talk about, you know, the things he's going to accomplish, right? And then he ends that prophecy, you know, by saying, you know, to anoint the most holy, and he closed the book, and he hands it to the attendants, and he sits down, and he says, today this prophecy is fulfilled in your hearing. You ever stop to read the actual text from Isaiah and what Christ Jesus was reading? If not, I encourage you to do so. Because Christ Jesus, when he read that passage from Isaiah, he stopped midway through a sentence. He didn't finish the full sentence. That sentence that he was reading ends with these words, and the day of vengeance of our God. He didn't read that part. Why? Because that's his second coming. He put a period where there's a comma. And so far, church, that comma has lasted 2,000 years. So here we have this pause, this moment of break in between the 69th and 70th week of Daniel, before the 70th week of Daniel begins. Now, additional details about this event that will occur during the entire 7-year period is described in Daniel chapter 11. In fact, what we know most about the Antichrist is not taken from the book of Revelation, it's actually taken from Daniel chapter 11. So, with that said, it's in our best interest to get and turn to Daniel chapter 11. And for the sake of time, we will not read the entire chapter. I'll leave that to your own personal studies, but we're going to read beginning in verse number 20. Daniel chapter 11, verse 20. By the way, this is a continuation of a prophecy given to Daniel from this angelic being. Verse 20, he goes on to say, then in his place, one will arise and will allow an oppressor to pass through the jewel of his kingdom. Yet within a few days, he will be broken, though not in anger nor in battle. All right, stop there. Most likely, he'll be broken, describing sickness, some type of illness. Verse 21, and in his place, a despicable person will arise on whom the majesty of kingship has not been conferred. But he will come in a time of tranquility and seize the kingdom by intrigue. You see that there? To get the full gist of what this is describing, I want you to listen to how other popular Bible translations render the same verse. The New King James Bible translates that verse this way. And in his place shall arise a vile person to whom they will not give the honor of royalty, but he shall come in peaceably and seize the kingdom by intrigue. The New International Bible translates it this way. He will be succeeded by a contemptible person who had not been given the honor of royalty. He will invade the kingdom when its people feel secure. He will seize it with intrigue. The New English Translation says it this way. Then there will arise in its place a despicable person to whom the royal honor has not been rightfully conferred. He will come in on the scene in a time of prosperity and will seize the kingdom through deceit. So the point all of these translations is making is that this man comes into power without a battle. He comes in through intrigue, through smooth talking, through he's a charismatic man. This is the guy that people are going to flock to. They're going to be able to think they can trust this man. He turns out to be the devil in the flesh. That's why I don't like using the term Antichrist. I want people to really understand who this person is. He comes in looking entirely different. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 3 should come to mind when we read this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 3 says this. While they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction will come upon them like labor pains upon a woman, and they will not escape. Wow. Keep in mind how far this was. 1 Thessalonians was written after this prophecy was given. Remember that this vile person will accomplish in Daniel chapter 9. He's going to accomplish a way for the Jews to feel secure and safe and set up an environment where they are allowed to rebuild their highly anticipated temple. Now, church, in comparison to this end time prophecy found in Daniel chapter 9 and the abomination of desolation that will be set up 3.5 years later after Israel confirms this false peace with this coming world leader. It's describing an activity that's going to start in the small little town of Israel, Jerusalem, but it's going to spread out and impact the entire world. The term Antichrist is used several times in the New Testament, but it's never used to describe the person that we call the Antichrist. He's never called that. The Bible describes that there will be several Antichrists in the world, and we've experienced them, and there will be more. But this one particular guy is so vile, is so opposite of Christ Jesus. In fact, the term Antichrist means in place of Christ Jesus. Some people think it means opposite of. It means in place of Christ. So, keep your place in Daniel, and please go to the book of Revelation, chapter 6. I want to show you something here. Revelation chapter 6 begins the start of the tribulation period. And this is the first six seal judgments. Let's read the text together, beginning in verse number 1. Verse 1, Then I saw when the Lamb broke one of the seven seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying, as with a voice of thunder, "Come." I looked, and behold, a white horse, and the one who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. Okay, stop there. Who is this writer? Yeah, you'd be surprised how many people think that this is Christ Jesus. No, this is the Antichrist. It's not Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus does show up riding a white horse, but he comes way into later, not until you get to Revelation chapter 19. This is the Antichrist. What is this bow he has? You ever thought about that one? Our first thought has often been some type of weapon, like a bow and arrow, right? And some of the lexicons that you may have will suggest that this is some type of weapon. But church, we must recognize that that's just a suggestion. And the reason for that is because that word bow is not defined. That's a fact. But here's what's interesting. If you apply what's known in theology as the law of first mention, the law of first mention becomes your mile marker for how that word is used and defined throughout Holy Scripture. If you apply that law, the first time that word bow is used is found in Genesis chapter 9, in verses 12 and 13. This is where Yahweh Elohim, Jehovah God, says to Noah after the flood, "This is the sign of the covenant that I am making between me and you and every living creature on the earth with you. For all future generations, I have set my rainbow in the cloud, and it shall serve as a sign of a covenant between me and the earth." A sign of a covenant. Now, listen carefully to this, church. In this passage, the word rainbow is the same exact word used in Revelation chapter 6. In fact, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, a book known as the Septuagint, uses the same exact word in Revelation that you see in Revelation chapter 6. It uses that in the Genesis chapter 9 passage. So, this word is describing a sign of a covenant. A covenant. How about that? Let's go back to Daniel chapter 11. We're going to start to wrap this up. Verse 22. "And the overflowing forces will be flooded away with for him and smashed, and also the prince of the covenant. After an alliance is made with him, he will practice deception, and he will go up and gain power with a small force of people. In a time of tranquility, he will enter the richest parts of the realm, and he will accomplish what his fathers did not, nor his ancestors. He will distribute plunder, spoils, and possessions among them, and he will devise his schemes against strongholds, but only for a time. And he will stir up his strength and courage against the king of the south with a large army. So the king of the south will mobilize an extremely large and mighty army for war, but he will not stand, because schemes will be devised against him. Those who eat his choice food will destroy him, and his army will overflow, but will fall down slain. As for both kings, their hearts will be intent on evil, and they will speak lies to each other at the same table." That sounds like what goes on today, right? In our Congress, but let's go on. "But it will not succeed, because the end is still to come at the appointed time. Then he," this is the Antichrist, "will return to his land with much plunder, but his heart will be set against the Holy Covenant, and he will take action and then return to his own land. At the appointed time, he will return and come into the south. But this last time, it will not turn out the way it did before, for the ships of Kittim will come against him. Therefore, he will withdraw in fear and will return and curse the Holy Covenant and take action. So he will come back and pay attention to those who abandoned the Holy Covenant. Forces for him will arise, desecrate the sanctuary fortress, and do away with the regular sacrifice. And they will set up the abomination of desolation. Stop there. Church, this is the Antichrist working with Jews who were against the establishment of the Jewish religion in the first place. He's working with them. They're going to be part of setting up this abomination of desolation. Verse 32. And by smooth words, he will turn to godliness those who act wickedly towards the covenant. But the people who know their God will be strong and take action. And those who have insight among the people will give understanding to many. Yet they will fall by sword and by flame, by captivity and by plunder for many days. Now, when they fall, they will be granted a little help. And many will join with them in hypocrisy. And some of those who have insight will fall. By the way, that's the apostasia, the falling away. Let's go on. And some of those who have insight will fall to refine, purge, cleanse them until the end time, because it is still to come at the appointed time. But as for you, Daniel, keep these words secret and seal up the book until the end of time. Many will roam about and knowledge will increase. Okay, let's stop there. So we get the idea. This is an end time prophecy, but about the desolation of the abomination of desolation. Now, skip over to chapter 12. Chapter 12 is a continuation of this prophecy, and look at verse 11. Verse 11, and from that time that the regular sacrifice is abolished, the abomination of desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. Anybody want to take a guess how many years that is? Yeah, 3.5 years. Oh, what an interesting coincidence. Verse 12, blessed is the one who is patient and attains to the 1,335 days. That's 45 days later. But as for you, go your way to the end, then you will rest and rise for your allotted portion at the end of the age. Now, church, verse 11 confirms that this period of time between the abomination of desolation is set up until the end of the tribulation period is called the Great Tribulation, and it lasts for 3.5 years. Now, next week, Lord willing, we're going to look at the different rapture views and evidence from Holy Scripture supporting the pre-tribulation rapture, and we're going to combine what we've learned today with understanding the raptured church. He that has ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Let's all stand. Church, the subject of the rapture of the church is one of importance. It is. But we have work to do. We receive our marching orders 2,000 years ago. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that Christ Jesus has commanded. Let's not forget that. It's easy to get caught up in this type of theology, learning about, and I know, I do it all the time, learning about the rapture, the church, and the Antichrist, and all that fun stuff, right? The spooky and scary stuff. But we got work to do. The world is going to hell in a handbasket. And as Christ Jesus put it, the harvest is ready. The laborers are few. The laborers are few. Let's be true to our calling. Church, every last one of you have a ministry. Whether you have realized it or not, you have a ministry. You have one. When you became a member of the body of Christ, the Holy Spirit gave you a ministry. And at the top of that list, I mean, it could be a number of different things, you know, but at the top of the list is to share your faith. The world is sick, and you have the only cure. We can't be silent. We can't be silent. People have asked me, are there errors in the Bible? Yeah, there's errors in the Bible. Lots of them. The first one was Adam and Eve disobeying God. Let's not make that same mistake. Fulfill your ministry. My Father who art in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for granting us ears to hear and hearts to understand. We thank you, Lord, for this timely message. And it's my prayer, Father, that it will continue to resonate in our hearts and minds and will continue to build our faith stronger in you, knowing that a time will come when you will call us all home to be with you in glory. Father, we all desire to hear you say to us, well done, good and faithful servant. But we recognize there's still work to be done. Father, your Son declared he's sending us out as sheep among wolves. I pray for your protection for each one of us, Lord. Keep us all safely in your hands as we proclaim our faith. Let us not be ashamed, Father, to declare the name of Jesus. Let us not be ashamed, Father, to reach our neighbors, our family members who don't know your Son. Let us not be ashamed, Father, to declare your goodness. And keep us mindful, Father, that a time will come when it will be everlasting too late. So, Father, I pray for a boldness among us, confidence, strength from your Holy Spirit as we go forth from this building. We thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you, Father, for the meal we have downstairs, for the fellowship period we have. We give it all to you, Lord, and just say thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for being so good to us. In the name of your Son, Yeshua the Christ, we give you thanks. Amen. Amen.